Well, first, I want to thank Zeta Fierro most warmly for arranging today's session and inviting me here. I know she had to overcome one or two obstacles, including the fact that she had to chase more than two biologists around the corner before she could find someone willing to face the dreaded Dr. Hovind in a creation evolution debate. Now, she didn't have to chase me too far because I've already debated the man back in April, and so I had some sense of what to expect. And he's a formidable opponent. He uses PowerPoint, he's got jokes, he's scavenged and collected a whole series of facts, pseudo-facts, misinterpreted facts, etc. to create a certain impression, and he's impressive at doing it. But you know, I believe in learning from others, and I believe that I may have learned more from Dr. Hovind than he's learned from me. In any case, I'm eager for round two of our match, or the rematch after the first match, and I'm delighted to be invited, and I thank you and your family for arranging this event. Let me just say at the outset that we operate a little bit differently. I'm a scientist, and under no circumstances is the theory of evolution under attack within science. Dr. Hovind may seek to create a different impression on this, but evolutionary theory, evolutionary biology, evolutionary genetics, and now this is going on. Have been well established in a growing discipline, which served the test of science, which is if we can successfully predict new phenomena and interpret existing phenomena successfully. Dr. Hovind is, by his own admission, an evangelist, and he goes about trying to trying to strengthen the faith of the believer, confound and convict the evolutionist, and win the lost to Christ. I'm not trying to do any of those things. In particular, I'm trying as a scientist to figure out what's true, and I cannot concern myself with whether what I find out to be true or believe to be true shakes your faith or strengthens your faith. And I think you don't want your scientists taking science based on trying to prop up people's faith. If science took that approach, the sun would still be circling the earth. And various other discoveries would be muted or never made because of the possibility that it would shake someone's faith. If your faith is weakened by knowledge of how the universe actually works, it's a problem for you to deal with. If you wish to come to me and ask how I've dealt with the same problem, I'm only too happy to share my thoughts. But I cannot take that viewpoint at the outset. I'm not trying to confound or conflict anybody or convict anyone. As for winning the loss to Christ, let's discuss what that means exactly a little bit later on. Let me just emphasize at the outset what this is not. This is not a debate between godless atheism and religion. It is not a debate between Christianity and evolution. The reason why it isn't is because evolution is as fully consistent with God existing as it is with God not existing. In fact, it's probably, in my opinion, more fully consistent with God existing. But I, as a scientist, could never prove that point and won't pretend that I could. More specifically, there is no contradiction between Christianity and evolution unless you take a particular, I believe, very narrow, distorted image of Christianity. That every word of the book that I hold in my hand, the Bible, means exactly what I tell you it does. Which, in my view, directly contradicts the teachings of Jesus. So the kind of Christianity that is pervaded as being anti-evolutionary and pro-creation and so on, to me, is inconsistent with the teachings of Jesus. Now, can you be an evolutionist and a Christian? Of course you can. Many have been, many are. I'll give you one little example. Myself. until the age of 13, and I only studied one book seriously, and that was the Bible. I'm just doing it in my mother. Now, at age 13, I discovered astronomy and the vastness and the beauty and the majesty of this universe were overwhelming and overpowering. Did that challenge my faith? Did I fall back and say, Jesus, you're losing your grip on me? Of course not. Quite the contrary. It made God's majesty, if you believe in God, only the greater. And furthermore, although it shrunk human beings, was that anti-Christian? Of course not. Jesus emphasized humility, not arrogance and pride, and the absence of self-centeredness. Stop this Israelite always talking about themselves and not seeing other people, etc. Try to come to a general set of principles that work for everyone. Now, later when I learned biology, there was a similarly vast story about the life here on Earth. 4 billion years, etc. So I was not so much attracted by the beauty and grandeur of that story, although it has all of that, but by the fact that it provided a logic, evolution through natural selection, that you could use to interpret the meaning of biological characters, the meaning of living characteristics. Now, there are two kinds of creationists that exist these days. There are the intelligent designers and the recent creationists. The intelligent designers accept physics, they accept chemistry, they accept astrophysics, they accept astronomy, they accept geology, they accept paleontology, they accept organic evolution. They just say that God has been behind the whole thing, that the whole universe and life is intelligently designed. I have no quarrel with that viewpoint. It doesn't brush up against my science exactly, because it would be very hard to define the work that would show you where the intelligent design was different from non-intelligent design or whatnot, but it is fully consistent with everything we know about the Earth and the universe. Now, the recent creationist, of which Dr. Hovind is a well-known example, they take a much different position. They dismiss all those disciplines that I mentioned and want to base their view of the Earth, of theology, of astronomy, etc., on a few lines in Genesis. And in particular, they want to explain the entire paleontological record, as I'll come back to in a moment, by the flood, by Noah's flood. Now this, from my standpoint, is an extraordinary fantasy. That Noah's flood and ark are a plausible account of the fossil record in life we know it today is beyond credulity. And I will then come to that evidence. But I will just stress at the outset that to me there are two very different views of the universe here that are being described, and of the God that's behind the universe, if such a God is there. On the one hand, I believe in a consistent, rational, sensible world without dreadful, inexplicable calamities that destroy 99.9% of species, all because human beings weren't behaving themselves properly. By contrast, Dr. Copeland believes in an arbitrary, bizarre, capricious world according to a private interpretation of a privately held book in which God creates the whole universe and obliterates whole sections of it in a mad 300 days because of disputes with the behavior of human beings and so on. All right, now let's get to the evidence. The fossil record. If there were no fossil record at all, and yet evolution were still true. For example, if living creatures, when they died, just pulverized, and so they could not leave an imprint, then it would still be difficult to prove evolution, although there would be many other proofs. But still, you would say, where's something concrete that I could look at? One of the most striking things is that life has left this imprint from earlier creatures, and this has been known and studied in depth for over 200 years now. And the vastness of the fossil record, for those of you who don't waste your time on this stuff, may be surprising. There are over 80 billion fossils that have been discovered, and hundreds of millions that have been described, cataloged, placed in museum collections, assorted, organized by strata, organized by time, etc. This is not 5 or 6 fossils. This is not 12 fossils in the horse story or whatever. This is a massive record of past life, of creatures that are not here alive today, but were clearly alive at some point in the past. Now, how does Dr. Hovind deal with this? Well, according to him, we were all alive before the flood, but then along came the flood and wiped out all the ones that are found in the fossil record. Now that creates, in the flood, that creates a whole series of problems. For example, what's the size distribution of creatures as you go down geological strata? According to him, that's just all mud from the big flood, and they got killed, and they died, and they got classified as different layers. We know that the denser you are, and also separately, the heavier you are, the more you will tend to sink to the bottom. That's not the way the fossils are organized. The largest mammals are very recent, near the top layer. The heavy creatures, elephants, their relatives, etc., etc. Smaller mammals are lower down, even though we know smaller mammals are less dense and way less. It should not be in that order. So the size distribution is off. Secondly, data. There are a whole series of methods, and this comes out of physics, chemistry, and so on, for dating rocks. Carbon-14 is one example. It works up to about 50,000 years ago. Argon, potassium is used if you want to go back a billion years. Now, Dr. Hovind is fond of pointing out inconsistencies in estimates. What he's done is gone and climbed around and found 20 estimates for carbon dating that are in contradiction. One says 3,000, and one says 30,000. Even though one is the skin of the animal, the other is the bone of the same animal, or whatever. But what he neglects to point out is that there are 50,000, 70,000 measurements of carbon dating. A whole world of consistent dating, which is in turn consistent with strata, older strata, dating to further in the past, etc. Now, scientists have a rule. If you have 50,000 observations in one direction and 5 in the other, you don't even pay attention to 5. If you have 50 or 100, you hardly pay attention to them. If you've got 50,000 in one direction and 5,000 in another, you've got a problem. You take it seriously and try to deal with the contradictions. So this is a fantasy on his part that there's no consistent series of dating that comes out of other disciplines in biology. There are minute details of the fossil record that are just absurd to imagine they resulted from the flood. For example, by our dating, scientists dated 70 million years ago around the world at strata that had the same kinds of creatures 70 million years ago, and dated 70 million years ago, you find a very thin layer of a chemical called iridium. And that's really dust. And what it is now believed is just a hypothesis. The time that the evidence is growing to support it is that came when a large meteor hit the Earth. It spewed up this iridium, which covered the Earth with it. It blotted out the sun for days and days and days. It was probably instrumental in bringing the dinosaurs to an end. How on Earth, in this incredible flood, with all of this water heating up and down by these little dust particles, kept at the same level all the way around the Earth at the level that corresponds to 70 million years ago by scientific calculations? All right, secondly, I didn't know some of these things before I had to make it the first time. I don't spend my life studying the arguments of trait of evolution. I'm all working in a particular area of evolution and genetics now, and I've got to do my work. If you're going to get to water by raining 40 days in China, it has to rain about 11 feet an hour. Remember, a minute an hour is a heavy down pool. 11 feet an hour would splat you to the ground as if it. Furthermore, I didn't know this before debating this man the last time, it generates heat. The release of water in the atmosphere generates heat. That amount of water would result in water that came down at about 3,000 degrees temperature. So you've got a boiling mass of water. It's killing everything in the water. Not just the fossils, but any other fish, etc., etc. How do humans survive that? I don't know. Well, last time he dives that by saying, well, he you'll find one little half a line that I think you can guess, where it talks about water gushing out from every corner. So now he wants the water not just to come down from above, but to come from down below. But we know that any water that does come up from below is superheated and comes up boiling already. The molten core of this planet is only about 5 kilometers below sea level. And the Earth gets very warm very quickly. Now, where did all that water come from? Where did it all vanish to? You can't have that amount of water. Water so massive that it comes to the top of Mount Everest. Water that's 5 miles high and then suddenly disappears in the space of less than a year, according to Jesse. Where'd it go to? Back up into the atmosphere, down to the rocks. It had to go somewhere. We got no evidence of it. Now, thirdly, the massive murder of the flood. Skip the murder of all the species that are no longer with us. You had millions of species that had to be without food for about a year. It's a fantasy to believe that Noah and his brethren were collecting all this food and all the trees. The seawater would have been diluted so that you wouldn't have had seawater with all this rainwater coming down. A whole bunch of fish cannot survive unless it's really seawater, etc. Number four, let me give you another absurdity. 80% of our parasites, roughly, that is our diseases, our viruses, bacteria, protozoa, worms, live inside us. Now another 20% can also be found in a vector, like malaria can be in us or it can be in a mosquito. Now that means, and this is true for all other creatures, that when we got together, Noah got together two lions, two leopards, two gazelles, two kangaroos, two bears. Each of them had to be sick unto death. One of them had to have 40% at least of the species diseases, and the other had to have another 40%. And somehow there they are, ill-fed, ill-cared for, having to walk back to Australia with their kangaroo. Meanwhile, they've got half the parasites almost of their species. Nothing like we've ever seen since. And what about the incredible arrival and departure that's suggested by this? Remember when Noah's flood was invented as a story, people didn't know the world was round. They knew of the world a few tens of miles away from where they lived. They didn't know that kangaroos, which we know are found in fossil records in Australia, would have had to walk from Australia and walk back. Polar bears would have had to come down from the cold where they could live to the hot climate of the Middle East and somehow to find no one climate for and so on. Then at the end of this monstrous event with a cauldron of 3,000 degree water in which the ship is somehow maintaining itself, they got to wait for the water all disappeared in some little rat hole that these people are imagining, and then they've got to walk back through all this blood and heartache over dead, stinking creatures and so on. This is your view of how God created the universe. How it develops off of a little story in Genesis? And finally, before I turn to that story in Genesis, what about genetics? And I deliberately asked Dr. Hovind about it last time, and I will ask him about it very early on in my questions, because I know he hasn't been exposed to this before, so let's see how fast he learned from me. Remember, Noah and his children and their wives, that's what we have on the human side, all the other creatures were marched in two by two. Well, what does that mean? That means they go back and breed. Then their children breed with each other, because there ain't no other line, right? Then their grandchildren breed with each other, because there ain't no other line. And every generation thereafter. And it's a trivial calculation to show, and we have evidence, I don't know how many bodies do have to show that this is true, that inbreeding obliterates genetic diversity within individuals. So every human being in this room, approximately, if you go down to your genotype and compare the genes you got from your mother, the genes you got from your father, at 10% of the loci, they'll be different. We are outbred species that benefit from outbreeding. We benefit from genetic diversity within ourselves. The world doesn't show that. That gets obliterated by inbreeding. You know the ill effects of post-inbreeding. You've certainly heard about it. You've certainly heard
and it just takes a few generations. You can, in 12, 15 generations, with that Trivers reading, you can take that to 1/100th this level. So instead of 10% of the loci being heterozygous, 0.1%. Yet if you look at all these features, a mere 4,000 years later or whatever, a mere 300 generations later, somehow they've all reconstituted the genetic variability that they lost in this century. Beyond credulity. Now, good, thank you. I'll be done in 5 minutes. Now, there was a real flood. Back in that area of the world out of which the Bible came, and which many people believe is the reason for the flood story that you find in Genesis. One reason for this is that the same story is found in related people, different religions, different religious traditions, but they have a flood story. Occasionally you find a flood story elsewhere, but usually you do not. Every people, whether you go to the school in southern Africa, whether you go to China, Malaysia, wherever you go, Eskimos people have what's called an origin story, an origin myth. But it's only there that they have this flood. Well, what was the real flood? Dated by carbon 14 and repeatedly redated, it was about 8,600 years ago, the flooding of the Black Sea. When the Mediterranean topped a natural land barrier and started spilling over into an area that was under sea water but had some freshwater small lake and a lot of human habitation. But you know, when a sea reaches something like that, it digs through and finally comes over at great speed. And it recently set bridges down there. And sure enough, there are whole villages buried down there, visible with the help of submersibles. The Bosphorus Channel is what we believe was the channel that led to this flood. The depth of the water now is roughly a half a kilometer. There's evidence that fleeing people from that area may have colonized sections of Europe because suddenly we see at that time a new way of doing agricultural technology which developed in that area. And I have other points that I would like to make and that I hope will come out both in questions that I pose to Dr. Hovind and you back to me and your own questions. But all I'm saying to you now is this is an argument between two very different approaches to religion and two somewhat different uses of science. He's an attacker of science, an opponent of science. I'm a science expert. He is not a science expert. He does not do scientific work. He does not predict events and so forth in science. He does his work explicitly to try to cast doubt on science, to bring people back to what is to me a very simple-minded and not very mature approach to religion. Thank you.
So I'm not against science, I'm just against evolution, just to set the record straight. Anyway, it's an honor to be here. Thank you so much for putting this together. You did go through some obstacles to get this here, didn't you? Need to get her story about what all happened on this. Okay, back in 1831, Charlie Darwin set off on a voyage to sail around the world. He graduated from Bible College to be a preacher. The only degree he ever got, by the way, and I'm sure Dr. Trivers considered Darwin a scientist, even though he never got a science degree. Darwin, as he sailed around the world, stopped off at the Galapagos Islands right there. There on those islands, he noticed 14 varieties of finches based on their beak shape. They were all finches, the same species of bird. He studied the birds carefully by measuring their beak shape and size, and decided probably all these finches had a common ancestor. I would agree, Charlie. It was a bird. And based on the variations of leaf shape, but this study was tested again, by the way, by the Grants back for 10-year study. This is from 9 to 10 millimeters. You know how much a millimeter is? They measured the leaf shape difference between wet years and dry years, and after studying for 10 years, they noticed the leaf shape varies on wet years and dry years within a few tenths of a millimeter. I agree. Variations happen. But there's still a bird. Okay? Then Darwin wrote his book in 1859 called The Origin of Species. Now, the Bible doesn't talk about species. It talks about kinds, and it says if they're able to bring forth, they're the same kind. You know, a dog and a wolf can bring forth. They can mate and bring forth. A dog and a pine tree cannot. Okay? They're a different kind. Charlie observed what is sometimes called microevolution. I object to the term, and I don't think we should use it, but they do, so I'll explain it. Microevolution tells us animals and plants can produce a variety within their kind. Variations can happen. It is observable, it is scientific, it is scriptural, it's also a fact. I happen to believe microevolution, if you want to call it that, works. It's fine. The question is, does it go any farther than that? For instance, we have big dogs and little dogs. These are probably the current extremes available in the dog family. But there's still a dog. And every five-year-old kid knows there's still a dog. I've had five-year-old kids do this all over the world. I'll give them this picture. I'll say, here's a dog, a wolf, a coyote, and a banana. Which one is not like the others? They get it every single time, okay? It's a dog. National Geographic ran an article about how the dog evolved from a wolf. I agree. If you want to use the word evolved, it's a variety of a wolf. See, the Bible says they bring forth after their kind, and that's all we've ever observed. We're going to talk tonight about evolution, Dr. Trivers at his request, about after life gets started, not about the first part of the evolution theory, which would have to be true. So I'm just going to put this in historical perspective for you. In order for evolution to be true, first we'd have to have cosmic evolution, the origin of time, space, matter. We'd have to have an answer for that one. Then we'd have to have the chemicals evolve. There are 92 known elements, the naturally occurring, plus the other synthetic ones. They would have to somehow evolve from nothing, from this Big Bang, hydrogen, whatever exploded. Then we'd have to have stars evolve. Nobody's ever seen stars form. They imagine a few are forming where spots are getting brighter, but they've never proven any stars forming. It could be, of course, the dust is clearing and a star showing from behind it. The fact of the matter is that the current estimate is there are enough stars out there that we know about that everybody on Earth can own 11 trillion of them to yourself. And we've never seen the formation of one of them. We see a blow up all the time. That's the opposite, okay? Fourthly, organic evolution, the origin of life. All these are major obstacles, but I'm going to give Dr. Trivers all of these. At his request, we're going to discuss tonight, did evolution happen once life got started? Okay. I don't think any of these four are possible, and I think all of them are insurmountable hurdles for the evolution theory. However, we're going to give them all those. Next, we have to have what's called macroevolution, and this is where the argument really centers tonight. Is it possible for an animal to produce a different kind of animal, and is there any evidence that they ever have? Then we have, lastly, what's called microevolution. I agree with this, and I don't like the word, but I agree it happens. Variations happen. I'm convinced the first five are purely religious. They are imagination. You have to imagine that happened. They never are observable. They are outside the realm of science. It's part of somebody's religion. I think it's a dumb religion. But hey, this is America, the home of the free and the land of the slave, or whatever, and you can have all the religion you want, okay? But I resent paying for his religion to be taught in our schools at my expense, okay? Evolution should start a private school to teach evolution to those that want to pay and come learn it, like any other religion has to do and push their faith. This textbook changes the meaning of the word. It says evolution is change over time. And you have to define this word, because this word is slippery, okay? I agree, things change over time, but watch how they change it in the book. In other words, living things have changed over time. They're just going to automatically skip the first four vital stages of evolution, which would have to happen. And I'm going to skip that tonight, too. I'm pointing it out. These are insurmountable obstacles. Then they say, evolution can be defined as a change in species over time. Well, now, I agree. That happens. I think species can change, but I think the species have limits. One of the lies in the textbooks is this one. That's not really what they mean by evolution. Variations certainly happen, but they have limits. Farmers have been trying for years to get bigger pigs. But they will never get a pig as big as Texas. There is a limit someplace, okay? Roaches in Florida, where I'm from, get resistant to pesticides after a while. But they will never get resistant to a sledgehammer. The point is, there are limits, and we can spend all day on that one. They still produce the same kind. And I'll stick with the Bible word kind, okay? Not species. Their information for the variation was already present. You can crossbreed dogs and get a Great Dane or a Chihuahua, only because the gene code is already in the dog gene code someplace. You don't get new information added. Real evolution would be an increase in genetic complexity. By the time you get to a Chihuahua, you are swimming in the shallow end of the gene pool. They have lost a lot of information. And two hours would not last in the real world, by the way. Go ahead, make my day, he's thinking. Anyway, real evolution would require an increase in genetic complexity. I would like Dr. Trivers to give us an example of one increase in genetic complexity that's ever been observed. This question was asked to Richard Dawkins. I saw it on videotape. They asked him the question, can you give an example of evolution where there's been an increase in genetic complexity? He was dead quiet for 19 seconds and finally said, shut the camera off, please. He can't think of one. I can tell you why. There aren't any, okay? There are variations of corn, but there's still corn, okay? You're never going to get away or a tomato hamster to grow on your corn stalk, okay? There's a variety of wolves, and they had a variety of dogs, probably had a common ancestor. This Irish textbook calls it divergent evolution. Oh, come on, it's still a dog. Don't give it a fancy name. It's a dog. It's not divergent evolution. It's a variety of dog. This Mexican textbook says this is evolution from a common ancestor, the horse and the zebra. Nobody argues with that. It's a variety of horse. And there are a lot of varieties of horses available today. Little tiny ones and great big ones. You can crossbreed horses, zebras. You can get zorses, zombies, yonis, zedogs, and zebras, depending on how you cross them. I agree, but you can't cross a horse and a banana or a pine tree or an elephant, okay? Kentucky Derby has proven in the last 100 years they've gone from an average winning speed of 127 to an average winning speed of 123. They've proven there's probably a limit to horse speed. And there's been a lot of money spent on Kentucky Derby trying to get faster horses. I mean, if anything would have shown us evolution, this would have been it. And nothing has changed other than just a little tiny bit faster. They probably have come close to reaching the limit of horse speed. There's a variety of cows, I agree, a variety of chickens. This magazine offers chickens for sale. You want to get cinnamon queens, red rocks, white rocks, cherry eggers? But then it says on the next page, jumbo fowl are the original bird from which all varieties and strains of domesticated chickens are derived. Did you know all the chickens had a common ancestor? It was a chicken. There are 8 kinds of bears in the world. They might have had a common ancestor, I don't know. But there could be a bear for one. Broccoli, cauliflower, your Brussels sprouts had a common ancestor, but it was a plant. This is not really evolution. Here's an English walnut tree graft on top of a black walnut stump. They do this all over California because of the English walnut nuts are better and black walnut roots are better. But you can never graft an English walnut tree on the back of a turtle. My whole point is, there are limits, okay? They're both walnut trees. Exactly what the Bible says, they bring forth after their kind has proven true in 6,000 years of observed human history. Now, if he wants to believe, or any of you want to believe, that there's been something other than this happened, you're welcome to believe that, but you just left science and went to fairy tale and don't even realize the problem. Evolution is a fairy tale for grown-ups. It's not a science. One more thing here. I collect textbooks. I happen to love the field of science. I've taught it for years, and I study it avidly, okay? There's no evidence to support evolution except things that have been proven wrong a long time ago. If some real evidence exists, I want you to show me. Now, last time I debated Dr. Trivers, and again tonight, he mentions several branches of science. You know, astronomy, biology, he throws out these words. He says, I don't believe in them. I do believe in them, okay? I do believe in real science. And I don't want you to just throw out a generic term and say, well, biology proves evolution. I want you to give a specific example, a real specific example of what proves evolution. If I had a theory, and I said, I think the moon is made of green cheese. Anybody can have any theory they want, okay? But then, suppose I said, NASA proved it when they went there in 1973 on a secret mission. Now I'm using lies to support my theory. It's okay to have a theory, but it's not okay to lie to support the theory. It'd be even worse for me to force everybody else to pay tax dollars to support me while I lie. I am convinced that the stuff that's used in the textbooks to support the evolution theory has all been proven wrong. It's a lie. I'm open for evidence. I'm open for discussion. I want to see some evidence for evolution. They say we've got evidence from fossils. Dr. Trivers mentioned that tonight. This is silly. Absolutely no fossil could possibly count as evolution. Think about it. Imagine you're in a court of law. You bring in your bones, all you found in the dirt. You say, Your Honor, these bones are the ancestors of somebody today. They would laugh at you. You can't prove those bones had any kids. You sure can't prove they had different kids. Why on earth would you think a bone in the dirt can do something animals today can't do? Dogs produce dogs, cats produce cats. No fossils count as evidence for evolution. And this is the biggest evidence they've got. And they'll bring it up 10 more times tonight, I'm sure the fossils prove evolution. I'm telling you, just from a purely logical perspective, no fossils could possibly count. Think about it. In a court of law, they wouldn't hold up 2 seconds. Okay? Evolution's dead. Some followers have a hard time letting it go. They lie and make things, everybody's fine. Oh, you never look better. Oh, pulse and heart rate feel good. Now, I'm not saying Dr. Trivers specifically lies. I don't know if he does or doesn't. But I know the evidence to support evolution in the textbooks is lies. And if he teaches that evidence after he knows it's been proven wrong, then he's a liar. I've never called him a liar, and I wouldn't unless he lied. Okay, I don't know that he has. But if he uses some of these lies to support his theory, then it's incorrect, and he should do that at his expense, not at everybody else's expense. Okay, textbooks will say natural selection are mutations as part of the process of evolution. I disagree. Mutations don't produce anything new. All they do is scramble information that's already existing. It's not an increase in genetic complexity, that's for sure. You have all kinds of examples of mutants, but they're not increasing genetic complexity. For instance, this textbook shows a fly, and it says normal fruit flies have two wings. This mutant has four. This rare mutation, like most mutations, is harmful. Beneficial mutations are the raw material for natural selection. Why don't they give an example? Why don't they show a picture of a beneficial mutation? I would like you tonight, Dr. Trivers, to name at least two or three proven beneficial mutations that increase genetic complexity. Because you would have to have trillions of those to get your theory to work, to go from a rock to a human over 4.6 billion years. Now, the one that they always give is sickle cell anemia. Here we go. This professor said, sickle cell anemia proves evolution. Because people who get, in Africa, who get sickle cell anemia cannot get malaria, or at least are less likely to get malaria. I said, well, that's brilliant, sir. That's like saying if you cut off your legs, you can't get athlete's foot. You know, that's not an increase in genetic complexity. It's a loss of information. In both cases, it's a loss of information. It's not a gain of information. Talk about natural selection. Natural selection selects. It doesn't create a thing. And they keep using this natural selection as evidence for evolution. Natural selection is a selective process. It's not going to create anything. We go through this for days on videotape number four. Selecting doesn't create a thing. Okay. The pepper moth is used in the textbooks as evidence for evolution. They tell the kids, they counted the moths on the trees and found it was 95% white moths and 5% black. And then when they burned coal in the factories, the trees turned black, so they counted the moths again. And now it was 5% white and 95% black. The truth of the matter is, the whole story's a phony. It didn't happen. After 40 years of watching, they found a total of two moths on the trees. Two. So they glued dead moths to a tree trunk to take that picture for your kid's textbook. This is a lie, been proven wrong years ago, it ought to be taken out of the textbooks. Even if it were true, it's still a moth, and it's still the same two colors of moth. It's a variation of the population percentage. It's not evolution. That's not evidence for evolution. But they still keep this in the textbooks because they don't have anything else. Okay, let's see. All the evidence that they give, I am convinced, has been proven wrong a long time ago. Let's see if we can get to a couple of things here. They tell the kids that fruit fly is evidence for evolution. They put the flies in the laboratory and nuked them and microwaved them and x-rayed them and did all kinds of mean things to make those flies have mutated babies. They got flies with curled wings. They fly around, couldn't go anywhere. They got flies with no wings. What do you call that? Crawl? You can't fly, okay? After raising all these mutated flies, they concluded there were absolutely no improvements. The natural limits to biological change, Dr. Lester said, fruit flies refuse to become anything but fruit flies under any circumstances yet devised. Well, duh. It's true fruit flies produce a variety of babies, but every variation they got was worse off. And this guy publishes an article in U.S. News and World Report and says, flies in the north have wings 4% larger than flies in the south, and that is proof of Darwin's theory. You've got to be kidding. They tell the kids to think critically. Oh, we can spend an hour on that one. They don't think critically. They don't think at all. Okay. They say evidence for evolution comes from homologous structures, from the forelimbs of birds, dolphins, and humans, from vestigial structures, and from molecules, proteins. Well, now, just we could take all those again and spend all night, but the evidence for homology is right here in the textbook. It says the human has two bones in the wrist, called the radius and the ulna. There you are, boys and girls. And the penguin has two bones in his liver, called the radius and ulna. Yep, that proves we've got a common ancestor. That's the message they get across in the textbooks. These homologous structures provide evidence that these animals evolved from a common ancestor. Talks about the crocodile, then same thing. Okay, it goes over and over. Seal sliver. Here it is. Comparative anatomy provides further evidence of evolution. Commonalities suggest that these and other vertebrate animals are all related. They probably evolved from a common ancestor. Now, if somebody wants to believe that, honestly, I don't care what they believe. That's perfectly fine. But that's not science. It probably proves they have a common designer. Similarities might prove the same designer made them. Hello? It's not proof of a common ancestor. Students are never shown there are other options. They're being brainwashed, not educated. This is all over the world. There's a textbook from Latvia, one from Ireland. It's all over the world. The same stuff. In Russia, I've been to 30 countries. They use the same stuff over and over and over. Similar design might prove the same designer made them. Let's see. I'm going to run out of time. They say we've got evidence from development. This is still used in textbooks all over the world, proven wrong in 1874. Here. This guy said the similarity between early stages and development helped convince Darwin that all forms of life shared common ancestors. Darwin considered this by far the strongest class of facts in favor of his theory. What they're talking about here is the embryonic development of different creatures. This Irish textbook says the presence of fish-like structures in embryos of different species shows these animals have evolved from fish and share the basic pattern of fish development. Others say the human goes through the fish stage, which they are. The evolutionary idea that Sigmund Freud relied on most heavily in the manuscript is the maxim that ontogeny recapitulates phylogeny, which is the embryo goes through the gill slit process here. That is, the development of the individual recapitulates the evolution of the entire species. This is baloney. It's been proven wrong 128 years ago. The embryo has these folds of skin right there, and this textbook says they have gills like a fish. That's a line. Those are not gill slits. Those little folds of skin later develop into bones in the ear and glands in the throat. They never have anything to do with breathing. I've seen people with five or six chins, and they can't breathe through any of them but the top one. Those are not gill slits. Hegel made up this entire stupid idea right after he read Darwin's book. Darwin's book was translated to German in 1860. Hegel read it and said, what a great theory. If only we had some evidence. Hegel happened to be an embryology professor at the University of Jena in Germany. He had access to photographs and drawings of all kinds of animals in their embryonic development stage. So he took a drawing of a dog and a human, and he changed them and made them look exactly alike. He lied, and admitted later that he lied. He made huge posters of his fake drawings to travel all over Germany to prove evolution was a fact. Now, on top of Hegel's drawings, underneath are photographs. Actual photographs by Dr. Richardson in, what's the school in England? One of the Oxford, there's about 20 colleges in Cambridge, which is there a few weeks ago. Anyway, I'll get it there. Okay. Hegel, at the University of Jena, his own university tried him for lying. They tried one of their professors. He said, I should feel utterly condemned were it not that hundreds of the best observers and biologists lie on the same charge. It's okay for me to lie because everybody else lies. This biogenetic law cannot be weeded out in spite of having demonstrated to be wrong by numerous subsequent scholars. The biogenetic law is as dead as a doornail, American Scientist magazine. Here it is, St. George Hospital Medical School in London. This is the guy who did took the pictures, Richardson. He said, Hegel confessed the drawing from memory and was convicted of fraud, but the drawings persist. Why did they keep this in the books? Hegel's exact chart was used in the textbook used in Pennsylvania University, West Florida, and Pensacola just last year. They're still teaching this, and it's in textbooks all over the world. Is it in the biology book you guys have here? Do you have that with you tonight? It's in the 10th grade biology book. They're still teaching the embryo has gill slits. Hello, folks. I know it takes a while to get textbooks up to date. 125 years is long enough, okay? Tear that page out of the book, okay? Ken Miller still uses it. He teaches at Brown University in Rhode Island. I debated Ken Miller once on the radio. He won't do it again. We tried everything we can to get him to debate again. And I appreciate you doing this again. But Ken Miller is using this as evidence. 1998 textbook used in Pensacola, Florida, using the embryonic gill slits. Presence of gills and tails, the gill slits on a mammal, this is simply not true. Here's a 2000 textbook, 2001 junior high textbook. The similarities provide evidence that these three animals evolved from a common ancestor. Vertebrate embryos and similar characteristics, it's used all over the place. Gills of a fish. Humans and fish embryos resemble each other because humans and fish share a common ancestor. Okay. Used in college textbooks. Evolutionary history of organisms is also seen in the development of embryos. Here we go again. Now look, if you have evidence for evolution, show me. But don't use this. This is a lie, okay? This is not true. So if you got some evidence, I would like to see it. Oh, man. I 5 minutes and I went to the wrong, hyperlink page. Excuse me, sir. According to evolution, things get better automatically, you know? Okay, here we go. Textbooks are going to tell your kids that the appendix is vestigial. This is a lie. Your appendix is part of your immune system. It's been known for years. You need your appendix. Now, you can live without your appendix. You can live without your adenoids. You can live without your tonsils. You can live without both your arms and both your legs. It doesn't prove you don't need it. The appendix is where the immune systems are initiated through the lower colon. Probably your encyclopedia tells about that. If you take your appendix out, you got a much better chance of getting quite a few diseases. But hey, sometimes that's the best option. Get rid of it if it blew up, okay? This textbook says the whale has a vestigial pelvis. Many organisms retain traces of their evolutionary history. For example, the whale retains pelvic and leg bones as useless vestiges. This is a lie, proven wrong years ago. They say, just imagine whales walking around. There's the bones they're talking about right there. Just imagine the whale walking around. There they are, Cambridge University. There they are. There they are, Milwaukee, Wisconsin. The whale pelvis. Yep. Just imagine them walking around. I tried, you know, I just can't. The whale pelvis is located far from the vertebrae and has no apparent function. Whale's pelvis is evidence of its evolution from four-legged land-dwelling mammals. This is simply a lie. Those bones are necessary, but they're anchor points that certain muscles attached to that allow the whales to reproduce. It has to do with getting baby whales. It has nothing to do with walking on land. So either these guys are all ignorant about whale anatomy and they should not be writing a book about it, or they're deliberately lying, trying to find evidence for their theory to spread to your kids. Now, honestly, if there's evidence for evolution, show me. But don't use this as a lie. Such structures, which are considered to be evidence of an organism's evolutionary past, are called vestigial. For example, hind legs of whale are vestigial structures. There are no vestigial structures, and if there were, that would still be the opposite of evolution. That's not evidence. They talk about amblyocetus. You know what they really found for amblyocetus is the dark bones here. We could talk a long time. She brings that up during Q&A. I'm ready for that one. I'd love to see that one. Amblyocacacetus, there's another one. All they found was a few bones of the head. Later when they found more bones of a different animal, they said, wow, it's like a wolf. The first one, though, they found a piece of skull, a small piece of jaw, and a few teeth. But the ear bones resemble slightly whale ear bones. That's all they needed. Proof. There's missing link right there. An ear bone. We've got in our museum a 15 and a half foot python snake. At the south end, he's got little tiny claws sticking out of the body right there. These little claws are attached to a little tiny bone that goes up inside the snake's body. We also have a boa in our museum, 6 and a half foot live one. You can come down and pet it if you like. But they say, this textbook says, the rudimentary hind legs of a python snake are seen in the skeletal structure. Rudimentary hind legs. Those little claws are used in mating, okay? The snake doesn't have any arms, and he can't talk. And say, he's good old Ronnie. This has nothing whatsoever to do with walking on land. Now, if you got evidence for evolution, then show me. But don't use this kind of stuff, okay? They're lying to your kids. This guy says, the humans have a tailbone that is of no apparent use. I debated an atheist one time, and he said, I got proof for evolution. Human tailbone. I said, sir, I taught biology and anatomy. I happen to know there are 9 little muscles that attach to the tailbone, without which you cannot perform some valuable functions. I won't tell you what they all are, but trust me, you need those muscles. I said, now, if you think the tailbone is vestigial, I will pay to have yours removed. The textbook says the coccyx, that's your tailbone, is a small bone at the end of the human vertebral column. It has no present function, and it's thought to be the remainder of bones that once occupied the long tail of a tree-living ancestor. This is simply a lie, okay? Now, tonight, I would like Dr. Trivers to be very specific. I don't want him to say, biology offers evidence for evolution. I don't want to hear that. I want to see specifically what part of biology offers evidence for evolution. Don't say, geology offers evidence for evolution. Give me a specific, okay? If you want to talk about the fossil record, I'm thoroughly prepared to do that. There is no fossil record. There are fossils, but there is no fossil record. They don't come with a date on them when you dig them out of the ground. All we know is there's a lot of bones found in the dirt. I mean, billions of them. None of them indicate a change from one to another. If you found one that looked a little different than something alive today, that still could prove an extinct species without a missing link. I'm telling you, in a court of law, they laugh at you for bringing up fossils. But see, evolution doesn't have to be proven in a court of law. It only has to be made believable to a bunch of students by a professor who has a very obvious academic and psychological advantage over those students. And I, for one, resent paying for that. And I think some other folks do, too. Thank you so much.
questions, Dr. Hovind can answer. And then Dr. Hovind, that'll be for about 10 minutes. And then Dr. Hovind will ask Dr. Trivers some questions, and Dr. Trivers will give the answers for another about 10 minutes. So, Dr. Trivers?
Respond with a few comments on the performance we've just seen. Hovind has a gift for humor, but some of it's so grossly inappropriate that it reveals some of the deeper biases of his work. And let me give you an example of it. He says that the notion that a gene that causes sickle cell anemia found at increased frequencies in sections of West Africa and other parts of the world that have a high incidence of malaria is a foolish notion, and that this would be a beneficial mutation, because he says getting sickle cell anemia to save yourself from malaria is like cutting off your foot to avoid, what was it, athlete's foot. Well, that was very funny, but yeah, you're welcome. But it's nonsense, and it's deeply insulting if you actually follow through the logic to the biological characteristics of other people, an issue I want to return to a little bit later when I get a chance to question this character. Malaria is not athlete's foot. Malaria kills over 5 million people every year. It is a dreadful, debilitating disease. Sickle cell anemia is also a dreadful condition, but as Dr. Hovind surely ought to know, the protection from malaria occurs if you have a single sickle gene and your other gene is the normal gene, that is your heterozygous, you have variability. Then you get the best of both worlds. You are protected from malaria and you have nearly the same capacity to carry oxygen in your blood as an individual with two normal genes. It's only when you are recessive for the sickle trait, that has have both sickle traits, that you actually suffer from sickle cell anemia. One of the problems that creationists have had, and I don't know whether this is true of this man or not, I'll find out a little bit later on, is difficult in explaining racial differentiation and difficult in admitting that races have been selected in different environments in different ways and that they are not to be hierarchically arranged, but are each better suited to the world they found themselves in than the other groups. How all of this took place in the 4,000 years plus that he allowed since the flood, I have no idea. He asserts that mutations never produce anything new, which is nonsense on the face of it. He showed you lots of mutations that were new. He said they're never beneficial, which he defines, if I understood him right, as causing increasing genetic complexity. But that's not the way any biologist defines beneficial. Beneficial is simply, does it increase your chances of surviving and reproducing? Sometimes having your genes be more complex does that, and sometimes being less complex. Our ability to map complexity, genetic complexity, on individual differences or differences between species is still extremely primitive. We have only recently shown by the whole genome mapping that the number of genes in the mouse and the number of genes in our cells is virtually identical. So if you think there's a difference in complexity or level of biological organization between a mouse and a human being, I happen to, you're not going to find it in increased genetic complexity. It ain't there. Now, he wants to name me a beneficial mutation. I can name you hundreds, depending on the species or the context. In the case of bacteria, many mutations have appeared and spread in the face of antibiotics. They were not caused, as I've read Dr. Hovind assert somewhere, I believe, by the antibiotics. They were selected when the antibiotics appear. And as most of you must know now, the evolution of resistance to antibiotics is a major and growing problem in medicine. We now often have to hit the same disease that could have been killed with one antibiotic, we have to hit the individual with three different antibiotics, cut it in three different directions to kill the organism. Why? Because beneficial mutations have occurred from the standpoint of the bacteria, which conferred greater survival and reproduction in the face of the antibiotics. Bacteria are not trying, so to speak, to benefit ourselves. Endless examples. A recurrent mutation in Australian blowflies, for example, it was kept at low numbers and been studied for a number of years. Australia has excellent genetics. And then suddenly along came a pesticide used against other creatures, which happened to hit the blowfly, and lo and behold, this mutation just happened to give resistance to it. It increased very rapidly in frequency in 20 years until virtually every blowfly had it. And simultaneously, it was incorporated into the phenotype or the structure much more efficiently. So other genes had been selected for that counteracted its negative effects so that the organism could enjoy just its negative effects. I don't want to give more examples. They're endless. And it is a lie, if I may use the language of this character, to imply otherwise. Now, oh, Lord. All right. There's a dreadful confusion. There's a dreadful confusion throughout his presentation between types of organisms, species of organisms, varieties within species, and so on. Darwin's finches, well, he thinks they all came from a common ancestor, but they're all a bird. Yeah, but they're all different species. They don't interbreed with each other, and the bird that they came from is sometime in the more distant past. Now, he says, you know, the dog's still a dog. Well, that's a great point. He says broccoli, cauliflower, and Brussels sprouts are still a plant. He says you can't graft a tree onto a hippopotamus. I mean, what is that teaching us exactly? The fact of the matter is that evolutionary logic assumes that natural selection has a period of time to work before species are formed. And if in the short period of time that we have selectively bred plants, we can produce broccoli, cauliflower, and Brussels sprouts, which are all in the same species, not just a plant, they're members of the same species, they interbreed, it is natural to wonder if 500 years, or 5,000 years, or 50,000 years of the same selection couldn't produce organisms way beyond interbreeding with each other, which is the origin of new species. Have we actually done this in real time? Yes, we have, it turns out. Busy beavers in their laboratory have bred fly species that no longer can interbreed with the original species from which they came, and which are, by definition, new species. They had to breed very specifically for traits that cause isolation from species. So this is just sort of ridicule and verbal amusement, but has no contact with reality. 2 minutes? Okay, I'll just make two more points. He tells us that unless you can see evolution taking place, in other words, unless you can go back in a time capsule and actually sit there and watch it happen, and then fast forward a few hundred years, and then a few hundred more, and then see it, if you can't do that, then the whole thing's fantasy, you've left time. That is not true. And if it were true, then an atomic bomb dropping on your head would be an example of a fairy tale that happened to turn out to be true. Atomic phenomena are not visualized and seen to the degree that he wants you to see scientific phenomena, but they're certainly a part of science. You cannot see a star being born because it takes, by any reasonable calculation, tens and hundreds of millions of years to take place, and you don't live that long. Now, he tells me at the outset, oh, he's going to give me these other kinds of evolution. He'll just concentrate on biological evolution as I wanted. But he hadn't given me nothing, because he still wants to start the Earth 5,000 years ago, so he hadn't given me nothing. Those other disciplines say that the planet has existed about the universe 15,000 years, the planet 15 billion, the planet 5 billion, so nothing happened until 4,000 years ago, and then living creatures appeared all at once. Most implausible. The gill slit stuff is a little sideshow that I can get into later if you want. The immune system contribution to the appendix is grossly overrated. As for the notion that the whale, that you are looking at a vestigial pelvis there, that's not a fantasy completely. We have a fossil record, pelvis. It's not a record, just a bunch of bones. We have bones of creatures, and they go downward in time, deeper and earlier sediments, also timed by timing mechanisms that are consistent, that show whale-like creatures with bigger pelvises, whale-like creatures with pelvises and limb bones, whale-like creatures, although less whale-like, with the actual bones sticking out in the flippers, and we even have lineages that strongly suggest which group they came from, which I think were cattle-like creatures, small cattle-like creatures. That's my response to what I've heard so far.
So in other words, we don't see it happening. Now that's why, that's what I said at the beginning, you have to imagine that evolution happened. It takes place in imagination. This is no different than a fairy tale for kids, you know, long ago and far away. That's what evolution is. If you want to believe, well, it could happen if you have enough time, well then go ahead and believe that. See, science deals with things you can observe and test and demonstrate. Evolution is not science. It's a fairy tale for grown-ups. That's all it is. And many evolutionists have admitted that. I can't hit every point we have here, because our picture may go for 20 hours and still not solve it. Let me just pick one or two more. The fossil record. Evidence of evolution from the fossil record. This is silly. As I mentioned earlier, there is no fossil record. There are fossils. And I have a huge collection of fossils. I have a lot of digging fossils. I went to Colorado 2 months ago digging out a dinosaur. There's no question. There are fossils. The question is, what do they mean? It's his interpretation he wants to put on the fossils. And I want to put an interpretation on the fossils. But the fact is, there is no fossil record. There are just fossils, okay? It's evidence. This guy says evolution is a fact. The fossil record provides for the strongest evidence that species evolved over time. This is silly. There is no, you don't look back in the fossil record. You look at bones in the dirt. And you put your interpretation on them. That's all you do. The textbook says fossils can contribute to our understanding of evolution. That's ludicrous. Darwin even said, if my theory be true about slow gradual changes, numberless intermediate varieties must surely have existed. Change from a rock to a human. There have to be lots of missing links. This guy said, since Darwin, many links have been found. I don't think so. David Roth said, in the years after Darwin, his advocates hoped to find predictable progressions. The anomalies have not been found, yet the optimism of die hard is pure fantasy scripted in textbooks. Pure fantasy. What creationists are asking for is a simple evolutionary criteria that would support macroevolution in the fossil record. This would be at least 40 to 50 successive fossil species showing major generic change. Top origin doesn't list a fraction of that number, but it isn't an unrealistic number if fossils get here is as old as the macroevolution is maintained. Berlinski said, there are gaps in the fossil graveyard, places where there should be intermediate forms, but where there's nothing whatsoever, it said. No paleontologist writing in English, French, German, or Rutgers denies this is so. It says, in fact, Darwin's theory and the fossil record are in conflict. According to Stephen Wu at Harvard, he said, as Darwin noted the origin of species, an abrupt emergence of arthropods in the fossil record during the period represents presenting problems in evolutionary biology. There are no obvious central or intermediate forms, either living or in the fossil record. We all say there are no transitions between any different kinds of animals. There's no transitions before the fish tantrum. The transition from spineless invertebrates to the first backbone fish is still shrouded in history. Where did all the birds come from? The two origin of birds is still up in the air. Caduce is one of the world's experts on birds. How about the whales? The evolutionary origin of whales remains controversial among zoologists. What about flowering plants? We can talk about all the fossil. Their fossil record, even if there were a date stamped on, even if they were billions of years old, still wouldn't prove any relationship. If I get buried right on top of a hamster, that doesn't prove he's my grandpa. So even if they are in order, which they're not, but he thinks they are, okay, even if they were in some kind of order, that still wouldn't prove an evolutionary relationship. Luther Sutherland asked major evolutionists all over the world, where's the evidence for evolution? Yes, Hovind Patterson, he's got access to the largest fossil collection on planet Earth, the British Museum of Natural History. He said, Dr. Patterson, I read your book about evolution. I noticed you didn't show any missing links. Why not? Where are the missing links? Here is Patterson's response. I fully agree with your comments on the lack of evolutionary transitions in my book. If I knew of any fossil or living, I would certainly have included them. I will lay down the line, there is not one such fossil. There are no missing links, folks. No chain is missing. The Google said the absence of fossil evidence is a nagging problem for evolution. Boy, there is. We've got a great theory. Only has some evidence. That's why we led a Richard Goldsmith 60 years ago, to say, the first bird hatched a reptilian egg. Look at the missing link, so it must happen quickly. That's ludicrous. They tell these kids to think critically. The fossil record shows an organism evolved in any small changes over time. That's a lie, by the way. Which theory best describes an organism's evolution? Gradualism or punctuated equilibrium? Explain. This is not learning to think critically. They're giving the kid two options. Which is it? Did evolution happen slowly or did evolution happen quickly? They do this in textbooks all over the place. According to the theory of gradualism, new species evolve slowly. According to punctuated equilibrium, new species evolve rapidly. Did it happen slowly like Darwin or quickly like Gould? They don't seem to be capable of thinking outside the box. It didn't happen. They give the kids two options. Did evolution happen slow or quick? Which one, kid? How about none of the above? This is not education. This is indoctrination. This is Soviet style. I debated Dr. Peter Eugene from Knoxville. I said, Dr. Peter Eugene studied and taught evolution of plants for 10 years. He got $650,000 in grant money. He studied evolution of plants. What's your best evidence for evolution? He said, evolution of whales. Now, you're a biologist or an anthropologist, probably three times tonight you refer to whales as evidence for evolution. You're outside your field. There is no evidence, and I'm telling you, there is no evidence in whales he's referring to. You didn't want to mention the names, but I got some on. I'm sure Amblesius, Apatosius, and the other basilosaurus, all of which, he even mentioned that came from a cow-like animal. You know how many changes have to be from a cow to a whale? Cows have their nose on the front of their head, okay? Whales have theirs on top. Don't you see a little problem moving it from one place to the other? And how's he going to live in the meantime? And this is just dreaming. This is pure imagination. Now, I don't care if he wants to believe that, honestly. If he wants to think cows turn to whales, I'm honestly, that doesn't bother me. It only bothers me that he wants to use our tax dollars to make the kids think that that's part of science. Is anybody else bothered by that in here tonight? Okay. Anyway, so, I think Dr. Pigliucci said one of the best evidence is revolution. Okay. He said the hippo is evidence for evolution because it's in the process of adapting to an aquatic way of life. He says the flying squirrel is evidence because it has half a wing. Why do you want to believe that? The textbook you gave me look at tonight in this school says talks about the moose being evidence for evolution because it might still live in the water. It's heading back to the water. It's going to be the whale someday. Some of the things he covered tonight, we've been talking about for days and days, not going to get you all over here. He mentioned that I bring up pseudo-facts and pseudo-science. Of course, I resent that. I try to be very careful with my facts. And if I've done something, I want to be specific and not generic. If you think the evolution of whales is evidence of evolution, then we can discuss whales tonight. Okay, I've got plenty of material on that. But I'm telling you, telling you, no fossil is in the county. Think about it. If you find a bone that looks kind of like a fox and it's got a whale and ear bone that looks kind of like a whale's ear bone, is that proof that the fox evolved to a whale? Anybody with half a brain and a little bit of common sense could say, no, that's not true. You might choose to believe that, which would be part of his religion. That's fine. You can have that religion. But you certainly follow what it's paid for. Took too long to see. Let's see. You mentioned the beneficial mutations as bacteria becoming resistant to antibiotics. You can ask anybody that studied this out thoroughly. When the bacteria become resistant to antibiotics, it's because there was a loss of information in the bacteria, not a gain. The bacteria lost information. I don't interrupt you when you speak. Okay? The bacteria lose information. It's like if you're handcuffing people and somebody doesn't have any arms, so you can't handcuff them. Well, that might be a benefit at that moment, but you can't handcuff them. But it's still a loss of information. The bacteria can't log on to the mechanism because they've lost information. There's a ton of funny stuff on this on the Answers Genesis website. Whole big article about bacteria. It doesn't evolve. It loses information. When they dug up the guys that froze that were trying to find the Northwest Passage, they found out that some of them were already resistant to, already had a resistance to penicillin. Penicillin hadn't been developed yet. How do these guys already have this resistance to penicillin in their system? That's just evidence. It's not really an increasing information. It's a loss of information. He mentioned the Australian blowfly. Mutant blowfly has some kind of benefit because of something changed in the environment. It's still a fly. Is that process, my question would be to Dr. Rivers, is the process you describe of bacteria becoming resistant to drugs, or a blowfly with a mutation being able to survive in its environment, is that process sufficient, in your mind, to change from a rock to a human, or from an ape to a human, or from an amoeba to a human, or whatever process you want to use? The fact of the matter is, there's 8 or 9,000 kinds of creatures on this planet, basic kinds of animals. And to think that they all had a common ancestor, he talks about genetic, inbreeding with people, Noah's daughters and sons marrying each other. Talk about inbreeding. He thinks everything came from a rock. What is the genetic variety in a rock 4.6 billion years ago? Man, talk about inbreeding. Okay, go take questions.
Liar. He claims I call him a pseudoscientist. Maybe my memory is even worse than I thought, but I don't remember calling him that. He's not a scientist. He's not a pseudoscientist. He's not a scientist, period. But never mind that. Why is anybody that he was a liar on? Because he does this and he does it frequently. He speaks with authority about things that he either does not know or, in this case, probably deliberately misrepresents. And that's the notion that bacteria that are resistant to antibiotics have invariably lost information. There's surely a case or two where they have, but we know there are many where they have not. They trade the information between themselves. You don't trade lack of information very easily between yourself. It's an unusual characteristic of bacteria that they're capable of doing this. And there are special mechanisms that I won't bore you with that permit this. It is simply not true that this is a loss of information. If I give you a blowfly as an example of beneficial mutation, he turns around and says, well, is it a new species? That wasn't the point. The point was there are such a thing as beneficial mutations, and when he claims otherwise, he is, to put it gently, misrepresenting reality. Now, let me ask you a few questions. I hope you can just get short answers on this. Is Noah's Ark a fantasy for adults?
I believe Noah's Ark story is literally true. I think it's logical to think that one person and his family could put two of each kind and seven of some kinds onto a boat. I think it is much more logical than to think everything came from a rock 4.6 billion years ago. Okay, so I believe it's more true.
Okay, now I just want to point out the double game this person is playing. Namely, if I cannot see something with my own eyes, namely an evolutionary change over long periods of time, which by definition you cannot see, then I've left the world of science and I'm in the world of fantasy, right? He believes that something is inherently true, He has not seen it with his own eyes. He cannot see it with his own eyes. He's just happy with it. He thinks it's logically consistent. That ain't science. That is, according to him, a fantasy for adults. Period.
If I were asking for the taxpayers to pay for the Noah's Ark story to be taught in the school, then the burden of proof would be on me to prove the story true. I'm not asking for that. You are asking for the taxpayers to pay for the amoeba's a man molecule.
Species, including ourselves, where do all these genetic variability come from that characterizes all outbreeding species today?
Well, I think I showed you from the I showed everybody from the magazine.
We're being flight folks.
And there's quite a few varieties of chickens, and they
eat the
green chickens. No, they all ate my common ancestor, which was a chicken. I had a family who came to my seminar once. They've been involved in dog breeding for four generations. They said, Hovind, for 100 years, our family has raised dogs. We are convinced if you give us 10 or 15 generic dogs, we can recreate every breed on the planet in less than 100 years. Sure, variations happen, but they're limited. They're still the same kind. So I think you have to go from two basic kinds on Noah's Ark to 200 varieties of dogs today is very doable, number one. It's all still a dog. Most of them wouldn't survive in the wild. They're made by humans for some particular reason. They wouldn't survive in nature. And still, minor compared to changing from a rock to a human, real man.
Well, again, he's failed to deal with the question. And
well, give it to me again.
It is quite out of will. Let me just deal with the nonsense and fuck out the nonsense. It is quite true that if you take 14 different breeds of dogs, you regenerate almost everything because they're genetically quite different, even though they're all inbred within the lineage. So when you cross them with each other, you have an enormous amount of genetic variability with which to deal with. He has jumped forward to chickens and dogs right now and failed to answer the question, which I'll state again for you, Dr. Hovind. Right after the flood, when these poor creatures had to find the world again to live in, and had to inbreed, how with all the genetic variability? How did it get regenerated so quickly in your worldview?
Well, you're sitting on what's called a straw man. They don't have to inbreed. The first generation, they married sisters. After that, they married cousins. After that, they married second or third cousins. So it's not a problem. It was Darwin married his first cousin intentionally because even up until 1850s, they thought you'd get better children if you married close to the family. So it's been throughout history, there were kings that had to marry royalty. The Habsburg family is an example, but it's required to marry royalty just a few hundred years ago. Sometimes they married their sister. They thought they would get increased gene pool. So, it is not correct that after X number of generations, everything goes bad. But it is, it's also you're saying with the straw man to say that they had to inbreed. First generation, they're marrying sisters. After that, it's cousins, and et cetera. And I think if you don't believe that all humans are related, this would quickly lead to the racist philosophy that races are radically different and evolved somehow differently, and therefore you're headed down the path they don't ever call it to become, one race is superior. I'll be careful of that one.
Okay. Well, again, he's failed to deal. I'll come right back to races and see how you actually think about them. But I just want to point out that this is no dealing with the problem at all. You have siblings made together, you reduce genetic variability immediately by a quarter, when the next generation does it by another quarter, etc. The fact is that you've got inbred lineages, inbreeding. You can do the calculations, trivial within population genetics. It's not an area of biology you master, and so you end up talking about whether rocks are green. Now, I think I will skip, another piece of science that is, I think, beyond you in terms of synonymous sites of genetics and why do they tell time that matches exactly the time that geologists give and which matches paleontological time as well. But let's turn to the races. I'm just curious how you fall out on this view. How did they get generated? We're starting with Noah and his wife and his children. How so quickly, and absent any beneficial mutations, and with this appalling record of inbreeding that wipes out variability, how did you get this wonderful variability in our species, including the Chinese, the Africans, the Asians, the Africans, the Europeans? How did you get it? No beneficial mutations?
First, I guess I object to the term race. I think there's one race, it's called the human race. I think it's quite obvious anybody who's been around, all of the so-called races are certainly interfertile and can breed with each other. So there is not really, the concept of race is pretty much overblown. There are just skin colors, okay? These are not different races of cows here because they are, you know, different skin colors, okay? They all look the same in the meat locker and they all taste the same on hamburger. So with that said, there are four basic theories of where the races came from. I believe probably the Bible illustrates the best, gives the best option. At the Tower of Babel, within the first 300 years after the flood, the Bible says God confounded them by their languages, by their nations, and by their families. In that case, you get people breaking up into small groups of maybe a few hundred, and they all speak, you know, French or German or Italian or whatever. And then there would be probably quite a few things that would cause different racial traits to become pronounced. Sometimes it's a mutation, like for instance, an extra pouch of fat in the eyelid that causes Oriental people to have more slanted eyes. It's no different than anybody else, other than something they have. The Norwegians, for instance, have typically blonde hair. The Aborigines have very small calf muscles. The Indians have high cheekbones. There are quite a few varieties that we call racial traits that actually are so minor compared to the idea of owning a rock. You know, I just
welcome back to the rock. Let me just, I've virtually exhausted my time. The rock of ages, I guess I have to think of it, possesses answers to everything. Let me ask one last thing, Dr. Hovind. You spent a lot of time disproving evolution or just casting doubt on evidence in favor of it. I gather you don't prove the recent case you think so much as just say you read the Bible, and so kind of convincing story to you. But let me ask you this. Has creation science ever predicted a thing?
Science would predict all sorts of things. We would predict, based on the biblical record, that if you dig in the ground, you'll find an awful lot of fossils because there was a flood that destroyed everything.
Well, we did that already. I've got a prediction.
But it's true. I mean, the Bible says there was a flood, and if you dig in the ground, you find bones. I mean, that's a prediction. That's fact. We find all over the world petrified trees in a vertical position connecting different layers of rock. Now, if you would like to believe those layers are different ages, which you've said several times tonight, you're welcome to believe that, but the scientific evidence is against that. I would predict we would find that if you crossbreed any kind of animal, you get the same kind, like the Bible says. Farmers plant corn, they expect to get corn. So the biological prediction that animals have varieties, but they're limited. I would predict that any breeder of anything, whether it be cows or corn, will find that there are limits, number one. You can't go beyond a certain limit. And the further you get from the norm, the more problems you begin to have. Like with the Great Dane or the Chihuahua, you know, they get hip dysplasia and they get problems. So I would predict there would be biological limits to the changes based on the Bible record. My turn. I would like to point out, I guess, for the record, Your Honor, that if the creationists were asking their theory to be tax-supported, then the burden of proof would be on them. But we're not. You are asking for the tax dollars to support your religion, so the burden of proof is on you, okay? So it's not on me. Now, you mentioned tonight that there are over 80 billion fossils that have been discovered, many of them cataloged in museums. I agree. I don't know where you get the number 80 billion, but I wouldn't question anything. I think there are a lot of fossils that have been discovered. I have a huge number in my museum. I would like to know from you, Dr. Trivers, which one do you think best represents a missing link that is an indication of one animal changing to a different kind of animal? There are 80 billion of them been found, millions put in museums. Which one is your best evidence for evolution, please?
Well, if I could, Doctor, I will give you one or two or three, but the best is kind of a foolish question in my mind. You cannot, from a single so-called missing link, produce a evidence for a general pattern that's very strong. But you have denied there are any kinds of missing links, and that, I think, is a rather extreme position to take. The coelacanth, for example, is being regarded as a living fossil because its anatomy, as you know, matches closely the anatomy of the group of fishes, the lobe-finned fishes, which paleontology and geology taught us emerged from the water, I don't know what it was, 300 million years ago or what. That's a missing link between huge groups, that whole group of vertebrates that are fish, and that whole group of vertebrates who live on land. Okay, into that, if you only want one.
Well, that's what I wanted, was your best one. And coelacanth is the first one that comes to your mind. I'm sure you're aware, of course, that they're not missing, they're still alive. So how could that be evidence of something that's intermediary if they're still alive? How is that? And are you, I'm sure, aware of the fact that the coelacanth has been studied very carefully since Latimer found the first one in 1938, and they do not use those limbs for anything other than swimming like a normal fish. So it's still a fish, it's still obviously a fish. Why would you say coelacanth is transitioning to something else? In 325 million years since the Devonian period, why have coelacanths remained coelacanths?
Well, not all coelacanths have. What I said was the living coelacanth is related to the coelacanths 300 million years ago, that's what it was, plus or minus R for many. For that, the fossil record suggests crawled out of the ocean and used those lobe fins to walk on, etc.
Okay. Textbooks do teach 325 million years ago, the coelacanth is actually one of the index fossils for the Devonian period in a typical textbook. They assume that these short arms before the fins were used for crawling on land. This is typical propaganda in a textbook. This is also a lie. The lobe fin fish are still alive. They've been proven that they don't change anything else. So if you want to imagine that the coelacanth changed to something else, I said, there's still coelacanth, and you said, it's not all of them. Now you've gone, I don't think you realize, if you just left science and went to your religion, you believe that long ago and far away, some of them must have diversified, because after all, they're different. But what evidence do you have? There would have to be something between the coelacanth and whatever they turned into. If the coelacanth is the best example of your missing link, it's not missing, and it's not an example.
Well, I don't like you forcing into a single missing link. Let's just say human evolution. And there you've got links that run right backwards through Homo sapiens, through Homo erectus, to Australopithecus africanus, to whatever they call the next one, to forms that diverged by 70 million years ago, close on to chimpanzees. So that's a series of links that support the notion. They don't prove it. They support the notion and provide increasingly detailed support for the notion that our own shape changed over time as you run backwards, dated and organized by paleontological record, and converge on a need like.
Okay, you mentioned the
human evolution to the caveman series. I'm sure you're aware of the fact that nearly all of these have been proven wrong over the years, like the 1912 New York Times and article Darwin series proved true because the Piltdown Man, who was later proven to be a fraud, or Nebraska Man, who was proven to be a pig's tooth, or Neanderthal Man, who's perfectly normal human, but still listed in textbooks. His brain is bigger than ours, 13% bigger. And it's just a matter of a person of old age and probably acromegaly. It's been documented thoroughly by Jack Palazzo, the dentist here in New Jersey, by the way, who has documented thoroughly that Neanderthals, perfectly normal humans, perform disease in great age. So, which specific caveman, I guess, or hominid, would you say has not been proven wrong? I think I have data on nearly all of them. To show that they've all been discredited as either fully human, fully ape, or unidentifiable.
I'm afraid I've got to call your veracity into question on this. Yes, Piltdown was a famous hoax. Yes, one or two other alleged fossils haven't turned out, but Neanderthals, if it was true, that an early theory regarding them was that they were had some dietary deficiency or deformed or whatnot, but there's a very detailed record of Neanderthals. There are hundreds of Neanderthal specimens. Furthermore, whether they were human in our sense or not, i.e. could interbreed with us, is not quite clear. I would assume they could. Whether they left any genes in our current population, I don't know. I do know that mitochondrial DNA that was extracted from a Neanderthal measured from geological time, it could be about 500,000 years old, showed that their mitochondria was just at the outer edge of the complete range of human variability, present human variability in that regard. Now, Neanderthals are a trivial portion of the fossil record of hominids going backwards. Homo erectus, as it's called, is spread all through Asia, found in Africa, spread through Europe, and that goes back to 1 million years, and there are, again, hundreds of fossils. You are talking gross dishonesty when you act as if every single fossil has been discredited as a hoax or as a dietary deformity. That is a
the Neanderthals, about 300 have been found. Their brain is bigger than ours. Their average height is roughly the same as today, 5'9" for the males, 5'3" for the females. The same skull was given to 9 artists. Here's the pictures. They said, what did it look like? They got 9 different pictures. What would you like it to look like? And as anybody knows, an artist can make things, look more ape-like or more human-like. Jack Palazzo, orthodontist for 32 years, studied the growth bones of the human face and said the bones of your brow ridge never stop growing, as do most bones in your face grow continually. If a person lived past 100 or 200, their bones would be huge over their eyebrow. The Bible teaches right after the flood, people live to be 400 or a few generations. My contention would be the Neanderthals were simply post-flood people that were living to great age. They're perfectly normal human, and they're recognizable as human. You mentioned Homo erectus. This one has been proven wrong quite some time ago. I'm surprised you would mention that. Just bring it up here. Wait for time for questions, please. Those of you in the audience here have got something to say, then do it in order, please. Homo erectus. Here we go. Used to be called Java Man, later called Hippocampus erectus. Dating of evolution is at 500,000 years old, like you said. It was made from a few scraps of bone found in 1891 by a Dutch anatomist named Dr. DeBoer. He had gone to evolution to look for missing links. He's not an unbiased observer. He hired a bunch of convicts out of the prison to go find bones. They were rewarded if they found bones and brought them back to him. What he found was an ape skull cap, 3 human teeth, and a thigh bone, which was obviously human, a year and found 50 feet away a year later. He put them together and said he found the missing link. He hid the fact that he found 2 human skulls in the same area, normal humans. He hid them under his bed, under the floorboard of his cottage there. So Homo erectus, I think you need to read the book, this book, Bones of Contention, and I'll send you one if you'll read it, about the so-called caveman by Marvin Lubinow, who spent 25 years studying all of these. So I think you're mistaken in his evidence.
We're going to have a quick his answer, and then you will have a question and you can say. So we'll try and get through as many questions as possible. Okay. The first question is, could you please explain the major leap that life made as it went from non-living chemicals to living DNA? Please show evidence of how DNA was produced from non-living chemicals, i.e. Amino acids.
DNA would not be made up of amino acids. DNA breaks the structure of amino acids. The curse-like chemical is believed to be RNA to DNA, but I'm just going to plead complete ignorance here. This is biochemistry, which I've never mastered, never even had organic chemistry as a course, and I know a little bit about the story of the transition from non-living material to living molecules, but I don't know about it in any detail. I can say that it is sometimes misrepresented in stuff I've seen on the website as being inherently absurd or implausible. But if a molecule came along and was self-replicating, then natural selection takes over and tends to select for any modifications of that molecule that enhance its ability to propagate itself, to use various chemicals from the surrounding environment, and so on. But this is not my field at all. And it's one reason why I had asked Dr. Hovind, and he kindly agreed, to kind of limit our argument, not to stellar evolution, chemical evolution, and even the transition to life, but what happened once life got an
opportunity. Okay, thank you. Number 27. Molecule came along that was self-replicating. That's a religion. He believes it might have happened. If it did, well, that's not science. My whole point is you just let you float in and out of science freely between your science and your religion and don't even see that you've done it. That's not science. Okay, science deals with things we can observe and test and demonstrate. The truth of the matter is that DNA is absolutely the most complex molecule in the universe. There is nothing close to a DNA molecule, or an RNA molecule for that matter. The thing that happened by chance is ludicrous, okay? If somebody wants to believe that, that's fine. But the DNA molecule is so complex, it's been calculated the probability of one of these molecules arranging itself by chance is 1 times 10 to the 119,000th power. Which is a big number when you consider the entire visible universe is 10 to the 28 inches in diameter. It just couldn't happen. Now, if you want to believe it happened, that's great. You believe whatever you want, but don't make all the taxpayers pay to put that in the schools. That's a fairy tale for drummers. Chimps and humans do share a large percentage of DNA. They used to think it was 98.6. The truth of the matter is now it's been proven to be 95%. I have the documentation here. If you'd like to get that. Even if there are similarities between humans and chimps in their DNA structure, that does not prove a common ancestor. There are similarities between Hondas and Toyotas, too. They both have four wheels and a steering wheel and windows. It doesn't prove any relationship. Okay. Barney Maddox, the leading genome researcher, said, they're trying to eat up my time, I'm sure, for the evidence for their theory, so therefore, it's, you know, it's a pun on the deck. Dr. Barney Maddox said, and he was the leading genetic genome researcher, he said, concerning these genetic differences, the genetic difference between human and his nearest relative, the chimpanzee, is at least 1.6%. That doesn't sound like much, but calculated out, that's a gap of 48 million nucleotides, and a change of only 3 nucleotides is fatal to an animal. There is no possibility of change. So he's the guy who did it and said it can't happen. They've now proven it's only 95% similarity. Okay. I agree. They're probably 95% similar DNA between humans and chimps and probably lots of creatures. But that still doesn't prove any relationship. I think you can look at the library down the corner here and find out there are thousands of similarities between the books of Shakespeare. It doesn't prove any relationship other than the common author. It doesn't prove that, you know, Hamlet and Macbeth evolved into, you know, Romeo and Juliet. It's just the same author wrote them. The same author wrote the DNA code, which is unbelievably complex. And the author of that code happens to be willing to forgive you for your sin and love you and take you to heaven if you ask me. Thank you.
Dr. Hovind can spread misinformation a lot faster than I can correct it. Let me just mention
mentioned back to the earlier comment of his, he says, when I said if the self-replicating molecule occurred, then this would happen. Right away, I left science when I put if in front of the sentence. Now, that's ludicrous if you know anything about science or logic. It's filled with statements. If this were true or is true, then this would follow. And we pursue those logical trains to try to get a deeper view of reality. Furthermore, he takes the longest DNA molecule and has it create itself with all its additional evolved complexity out of nothing. What you're imagining is a little snippet of RNA that starts self-replicating. Now, regarding his chimpanzee foolishness, all of that is nonsense, and trust me on that. I've spent 15 years trying to master genetics and evolutionary genetics, and I think I know a little bit about it. It is nonsense to say 48,000 nucleotides are missing from chimpanzee to humans. They have not difference in nucleotide number, but a difference in what they are. That's the 1.6% we're talking about. We're not saying that chimps are missing it or were missing. Furthermore, he says if you have three nucleotides missing, that is fatal. That is nonsense. That is only true within genes, and then it's only true within some locations within genes. And if you look at our total genome, which is 3 billion nucleotides, only about 1 to 5% of those nucleotides actually consist of genes. All the others you can delete nucleotides up to hundreds and have the organism unaffected. That's well-known genetics.
Inbreeding,
do you believe that many male and female animals of the same species evolve simultaneously? Well, when you've got two sexes, yes. If not, doesn't the theory of evolution fail where you say the creationist blood belief fails? I.e. inbreeding would still be necessary for propagating species in the evolutionary viewpoint. I'm a little bit befuddled by the question. The two sexes in sexually reproducing species evolve together and in a complementary mode. I don't understand, if not, you're saying, does the theory of evolution fail? Well, if they didn't evolve simultaneously and interdependently, it'd be hard to understand how one of them managed to reproduce without the other. The rest of the question I don't understand. I will say one thing about the evolutionary approach to issues that are in the Bible. The Bible tells another one of these little fantasies for adults, but one that Dr. Hovind wants to embrace and bring people to the Lord over. And that is that God, when he created us, created Adam first. Adam is the major one. Adam is the male, the man, the dominant and important figure in our species. He said he needs to help me. He caused a deep sleep to fall over. He removed the rib. He formed Eve out of it. Never mind, there's no evidence for that. Nobody's dipping the rib and so on. The question, the point is, from evolutionists, that's completely backwards. There's no such thing as an all-male species for obvious reasons. We ain't capable of producing offspring by ourselves. There are hundreds of thousands, trust me, of species that consist of all females because they can reproduce themselves. So some of these biblical stories, told with the old masculine name and with a fairy tale to fit that, I think are unfortunate, to put it mildly, and directly contradicted by a deeper knowledge of biology.
All right, his notion that the sexes evolve simultaneously is pure fantasy. There's no evidence for that whatsoever. If he wishes to believe that, that's fine, but I would like to hear a clear explanation of how you go from asexual reproduction to sexual reproduction and how this happened mechanically. You know, there's all kinds of problems can happen. I taught biology and anatomy. I think I can handle any evidence you can give if you think you have some concrete evidence other than a fairy tale of, well, it must have happened because we're here. I think the question, though it is a little convoluted, that was asked Doesn't evolution have the same problem that the creationists claim? The creationists would claim all the dogs in the world came from two dogs on Noah's Ark. The question, I think, is asking, if evolution happened at some point long ago and far away, you had a dog evolve. Don't you have the very same problem if there are 250 or 400 varieties of dogs today? They all had to come from that dog. So you still got the inbreeding problem, only now you put it long ago and far away. It's so different. Yes, you have the very same problem. I agree. Good question.
Dr. Hovind, question to you. What evidence is available to support creation?
Well, I don't think you have to light a candle to see the sun. I think if you walk into the woods and you find a painting hanging on a tree, it's logical to conclude there was a painter, even if you don't ever see the painter. You don't find any footprints, you find no evidence. You find a painting, that's proof there was a painter. If you walk into the woods and you find a building, that's evidence there was a builder, even if you can't find the guy. If these paleontologists are digging through the dirt around here and they find an arrowhead, they automatically conclude it was man-made. They would never dream that an arrowhead fashioned out of flint was a naturally occurring object. Naturally occurring objects are easily distinguishable from man-made artifacts, and it's distinguishable by most five-year-olds. I think if you find a creation, you'll say there must have been a creator. Now, who was the creator? Is it Allah or Buddha or Jehovah? That's a whole different set of arguments. But the fact is, there must have been a designer. I think the design itself, the design of the universe at every level, micro to macro, proves there was a designer. I was in Japan. I did not see the guy who makes the Casio Data Bank watch, but I think it's logical for me to sit here in New Jersey and say there must have been a designer for this watch. These things don't happen by themselves. And this watch is child's play compared to one cell in the human body. One cell in the human body is more complex than a space shuttle, the most complex thing ever built by man. And if anybody wants to think that happened by chance, they're welcome to believe that. That is a wildly silly religion. It's not science. That's design is evidence of a designer.
The design is evidence of designer is such a feeble argument. It was handled hundreds of years ago, long before evolutionary theory. But let me point out two things. First of all, he says if he goes out in the woods and sees a painting hanging on a tree, it's logical to conclude. He didn't see it, but it's logical to conclude that someone painted it and hung it there. And I agree with it. But I don't know why it is when I, or a fellow scientist, finds it logical to conclude something that we haven't seen with our naked eyes, that we're off there in fantasy land trying to sell our religion and force tax dollars on you all to sell it to your children. But he's permitted to make logical conclusions. It's silly. It's no definition or understanding of how science actually works. The rest of his argument boils down to one assertion. The world exists, therefore someone had to create it. That's the logical structure of it, no more, no less.
This question is from Dr. Trivers. Have we ever observed new information added to the gene pool of any kind?
Well, yeah. Again, you can go to bacteria, if you don't mind a really humble example, where they have numerous mechanisms for adding genetic material to them, in part because they have very spare genomes, typically. They're stripped down for other reasons. So, for example, bacteria can acquire genes by eating them, literally. I mean, by consuming them, ingesting them, I should say, from the rest of the environment and incorporating them into them. So, yes, if you want an example, that's an example.
Okay, I think that's a classic example of the best they've got for evidence for evolution. But notice, this gene already existed in some other organism. The bacteria ingested it and incorporated it. There are creatures in the sea that will eat poisonous animals and ingest their poison glands and put them into their own skin. Okay, there are numerous examples of that. That's not an example of evolution by adding by a mutation causing increased genetic complexity. This is an animal ingesting the already complex information that another animal had. And I don't know if he saw the fallacy of his argument, but anybody else see that? That's a very fallacious argument. Thank you.
Dr. Hovind, this is for you. How do you account for the similarities between humans and apes?
Well, I think first of all, I would say that the differences between humans and apes are enormous, okay? The similarities are because we have similar duties to perform in life. We have to walk, move around, find our food, etc. I think any similarities between organisms of any kind could easily be characterized as evidence of a common designer. As I mentioned, Toyotas and Hondas have many similarities. So what? That proves they have. It's a design that works. You know, four wheels on the ground and a steering wheel and something to sit on. That's all the design is necessary and works. So I think if we look at similarities between humans and chimps and conclude there's a common designer, that's just as logical as concluding there's a common ancestor. I think even more logical than concluding there must have been a designer. I would point out that there are 26 basic letters of the alphabet. We can go around the corner to the library and find that probably every one of those books in there is built on that same code, 26 letters. If the dictionary has the same 26 letters as the Encyclopedia Volume S does, that doesn't prove one evolved from the other or they both came from a explosion in a print shop. That proves that's the code with which you write English. So there are 20 amino acids. All animals have these 20 amino acids in the proteins. That doesn't prove any relationship. That's the code with which you make proteins. And it has to be that way, so the brown cow can eat the green grass and give the white milk and make the yellow butter, and I eat it and get the blonde hair. If it weren't for all similar proteins and similar amino acids, we could only digest and eat each other. And God made it so that animals, you know, you can eat a variety of things. So the similarities proves a common designer who would really think ahead.
Similarities on evolutionary grounds, common sense, etc., etc., and would back it up with a voluminous fossil record. But there's no question that you can easily entertain the hypothesis that a creator decided to create a group of organisms along a very similar body plan with almost all the same genes for whatever purpose he or she had in mind. There's no way you can disprove it. If you isolate individual facts like that and want to treat them as determinant on creation or and recent creation or evolution, then they're often not going to be determinative. We deal as scientists much more with the preponderance of evidence, and in this case, the vast preponderance of evidence.
Okay, Dr. Trivers, why doesn't the geologic column appear anywhere in the world in the proper order?
I don't know what that question means exactly, and I don't know what the right order means or anything, so I'm going to beg out of that one.
The geologic column is a hoax. It doesn't exist any place on planet Earth except in the textbooks and the imagination of those who believe in it. I taught her science for 15 years. It's true there are many layers to the strata. That's not a question. That's quite obvious, okay? I've been to all 49 states. I've been to all 50 states in many countries. There's no question there are layers to the strata. The question is, does it mean something? It could mean hydrologic sorting, that if you shake a jar of dirt with water, it'll settle into layers in a few seconds. You go to the mall and buy those things with all the different colored sand in there, and flip it over, and it settles into layers in a flash. It just takes a few seconds. Hydrologic sorting is a well-known phenomenon, well-studied, and you don't need to rely on evolution as an answer. I think the biblical flood, the year-long flood, is the best explanation for this. All over the world, layers of rock are certainly found. There's no question about that. But the question is, if they're different ages, then I would ask, why aren't there erosion marks between these layers? There are no erosion marks. There are no fossil canyons. The fact of the matter is, it's not a geologic column. It's a bunch of layers of different rocks on top of each other. And you can get the same effect in a few minutes with a jar of dirt and some water. Just shake it up, and it's sorted into particles for you. All over the world, petrified trees are found standing up in the vertical position connecting these layers. So when the textbook says the layers are different ages, I think that is obviously not common sense. In a court of law, it can be proven wrong very quickly. In many, many states and many countries, I have dozens of these pictures on my website, petrified trees standing up, connecting layers that the evolutionists say are different ages. I don't know how long it takes for a dead tree to fall down around New Jersey, but I know in Florida, you get 3 to 10 years, and it's going to fall over. It's not logical to say those layers are millions of years different in age when we have petrified trees by the hundreds out in the vertical position. And we have lots on that on my website, hunterdino.com. Thank you.
We have one last question, because We have one last round of questions. I find that I try to give direct answers to questions, and we get a whole essay on other topics and so on, a whole set of new misrepresentations, including these fossil trees, which were explained 150 years ago and are well known.
We have one question. That goes along with the point of question that you just had, and then we have one other set of questions. Okay?
I got all my.
Is to be truly unbiased scientists, shouldn't we be teaching intelligent design in the textbooks along with the theory of evolution?
To be truly unbiased, the question is, should we be teaching intelligent design along with evolution? I guess to be truly unbiased, we should be willing to question, should we even have a public school system? We need to back up a few steps. If we're going to have a public school system supported by the tax dollars, then should we get into origins at all? Because no matter what you talk about in origins, if you talk about creation or evolution or intelligent design or any other flavors in between, you're going to offend somebody. But it is not possible to discuss the subject of origins without getting somebody upset. So I would question, we probably shouldn't even have public schools, but if we have them, they shouldn't get into origins at all. I'm not one of those that advocates teaching creation in public schools. There are those who do, I understand. I am one of those who advocates we should teach science in science class, and we should not allow people to use lies to support their theory. If you believe we came from an ape, that's fine. Don't lie to the kids and to tell them we've got evidence. Don't tell them about the gill slits or the tailbone or these things that I proved on my video number 4. Just don't lie to the kids. Show the evidence, and if you don't have evidence to your theory, I'm sorry, get a new theory. That's how science works. And there's no evidence for evolution to lie. So I'm an advocate of not teaching lies to the kids. As far as intelligent design, I think if all schools were private schools and every religion had their own, then the Jews could teach what they believe, and the Christians what they believe, and the atheists what they believe, that'd be fine. I think that's about the only way you can solve this problem.
My comment very short. I hope we can get to short more questions and be done here. I've got a light to leave. And I don't know what to say about that. I mean, what was all that stuff? Should we have public schools? Well, he didn't quite answer the question. He said, once again, he didn't want lies told to children. He certainly doesn't want public money spent lies telling children. But he tells whopper after whopper after whopper. And I didn't have the time in my questions earlier to deal with some of the lies he told about early embryology. Yes, Hinkle misrepresented his work, but it's a fact of life that's been so abundantly proven in embryology and then embryological genetics that the very early stages of organisms after organisms resemble each other much more than later stages, which does not prove evolution, but is certainly consistent with it, and is consistent, it is easily consistent with it. Regarding the some of his other lies earlier, I'm just not going to elaborate, except to say, no, I'm not going to say anything more about any of this.
Okay, this is the last set of questions. Dr. Trivers, since there are so many millions of fossils, why aren't the books on evolution filled with pictures of fossils of transitory... transitional forms? Half fish, half land animals, for example.
As I've tried to indicate for a whole series of groups, and I only indicated it with human evolution, there are a whole series of transitional forms, not a single one with half chimpanzee, half human, and all the characteristics visible to the naked eye when you're only looking at skeletons, which you're not used to interpreting. Your textbooks would, I think, if one took that approach as a teacher, be packed with page after page after page after page of fossils that get more and more looking like human, let's say, and finally they're there. And then you'll say, oh, well, that doesn't show anything. Maybe it shows something about humans, probably doesn't. You want to see it for all these other groups. It's just not a, I guess it's not believed to be an effective way to teach. And it's certainly not felt to be as necessary as Dr. Hovind would lead you to believe, since he repeatedly misrepresents the actual evidence that does exist.
Okay, a couple of things. First, I would say I have heard numerous times tonight Dr. Trivers say that I misrepresent the facts, and I want to go on record as saying I resent that. I think I tried very hard to represent the facts clearly and carefully. Secondly, he said several times I did not answer certain questions. How many of you felt that I did answer the question that was asked in those cases? I will stick by my guns that there is no such thing as a fossil record. There are simply billions of fossils in the ground. Now, if you want to put your interpretation on them, that's fine. That's what everybody does. But the fact is, we find bones in the dirt. End of story. All you know is it died. And if you think there's a missing link, so I would like to ask Dr. Trivers. I know it's my response to him. He got to go first, but I'll give him another chance to talk. Do you disagree, then, when Colin Patterson says, who has the largest fossil collection in the world, when he says, I agree with your comments on the lack of evolutionary transitions in my book. If I knew of any fossil or living, I would certainly have included them. I will lay it on the line. There is not one such fossil. Is he lying? Is he wrong? You know something he doesn't know. He didn't want to respond. Why is there a
The last question is, don't we have transitory fossils, hominids, such as Lucy, proving evolution?
Johnson found Lucy 2 weeks before his grant money ran out. He had gone there on a grant to find some missing links. He was desperate to find something in the last 2 weeks. Lucy was 3 feet tall. Charles Oxnard studied every single bone of Lucy, did what's called a computer multivariate analysis, comparing the length to width, the width, depth, the ratios, all these things. He said, after 16 years of studying the bones of Lucy, Lucy is an unusual chimpanzee-type creature. It is definitely not a missing link. It was 3 feet tall. There are some creatures in Sumatra down near Vietnam that are very, very similar skeletal structure to Lucy and maybe the same thing. Again, Lucy was both found in the dirt. You don't know that Lucy had any kids. You sure don't know if she had different kids. And you don't know any much more about it than 40% of the skeleton was found. 3 feet tall, people was looked at and said it was a chimpanzee or some kind of type of ape-like creature. And that is not evidence of evolution. That's not evidence of hyperactive imagination. It should have been on probably some kind of drug to calm you down.
I think this final example is typical of so much of the performance we've been treated to from Dr. Hovind. Full of extraneous, irrelevant material designed to mislead. Whether the man's grant was running out or was not, he found a fossil, described it, and so on. You can always find scientists that will take a different view of a given piece of evidence, especially when it first occurred. There are a whole series of fossils like Lucy, not in Sumatra, if I heard him say that, but in East Africa, in Kenya and Tanzania, including the famous Lytle footprints laid down around 3 million years ago. All these things are dated back to the same time. So this is not fantasy, and the stuff he tosses up about what year it was Johansson found it, whether he advanced money or not, is all so much irrelevancy. Now, to get back to the previous one that people thought I'd done, no, I want to stick to the format here, and I want to go home and get a good night's sleep so I can do some evolutionary genetics tomorrow. One of his little devices is to comb the printed world for quotations, often taken out of context, and used to suggest something different. He's done it over and over and over again. You'd never guess that Stephen Jay Gould is a major supporter of evolution, because he finds a little quote in which Gould says, hey, speciation might have occurred quickly, which is what Stephen Jay Gould's hobby horse. He'll quote Fiducia, expert on birds, who believes in their evolution as they came from crocodile forms and so on. Yet the quote he holds out in the context he does makes you think that these major scientists are doubting evolution itself. It is not true. Now, where he hauled out this bizarre quote that after looking at 80 million fossils or whatever he had in his collection, he still couldn't find a missing link, I don't know, and I don't know what the man meant by it. There is ultimately, you know, the notion that there's a single missing link is a kind of hopeless venture. Especially when antagonistically viewed. There are a whole series of links that gradually increase your confidence that you can establish connections between these sets of non-reproducing bones, as you can say.
We hope you've enjoyed this video series on creation, evolution, and dinosaurs. Much more important, though, than knowing all the truth and facts about science is to know the truth about whether you're going to heaven or not. If you've never trusted Christ as your Savior, let me explain quickly what you need to do to go to heaven. The Bible says we're all sinners. We've all broken God's laws. We've disobeyed the Creator. We've done wicked things. We're sinners. Some are worse than others, at least in man's eyes, but we've all broken God's laws. And the Bible says you have to repent. The word repent means to turn. It actually means two things, to turn from your sin and to turn to God. God's looking for a change in your attitude where you say, Lord, I don't want to do wrong anymore. I'm sorry, I've offended you. I want to do right. And you turn from sin and you turn to God and say, God, would you please forgive me? Would you save me? The Bible says in Romans chapter 3, verse 23, that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. You need to admit you're a sinner. Number two, the Bible says in Romans 6, 23, the wages of sin is death. We deserve to die and go to hell because of our sin. But Jesus died for you. He loves you. He wants you to come to heaven. And anybody that will ask Him for the free salvation, God will give you the gift of eternal life, it says in Romans 6, 23. It's a free gift. And it says in Romans chapter 10 and verse 13, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. If you would just call and say, Lord, I'm a sinner. Would you please forgive me? And ask Him. He will give you that free gift of eternal life. Why don't you just pray with me right now and you could receive Christ as your Savior. There's no magic words. God's looking at your heart. But if you could say this and mean it, God would forgive you. Just say, Dear Lord Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner. I've broken your laws. I'm sorry. Please forgive me. Please apply your blood to my account. Forgive my sins and take me to heaven. In Jesus' name, amen. The Bible says, if you call upon the Lord, you shall be saved. So if you've asked the Lord to save you, He promised He'd save you. Now your job is to grow. Read your Bible, pray, get involved in a good Bible-believing church, and begin to grow to be a good Christian. Thank you so much. Call or write if we can be any help at all. We'd be glad to help.